Welcome to the module on implementation strategies. My name is Prajakta Atsol, and I'm a cancer prevention fellow working with the implementation science team here at the National Cancer Institute. Let me begin by giving you a brief overview for this webinar. We'll begin by talking about what implementation strategies are, what is their role in implementation science, how they've been categorized and classified and measured in the past in the current literature. I'll conclude with some example research questions for your current research proposals. So with that, let's begin. And at the quest of reiterating our definitions over and over again, I would love to begin with the way NIH defines implementation research, which is the scientific study of the use of strategies to adopt and integrate evidence-based interventions into clinical and community settings in order to improve patient outcomes and benefit population health. What I want to point out within this definition is the use of the word strategy. And today, that's what we'll be focusing on in this module. So as you've become more and more familiar with the model put forth by Proctor and colleagues, this is the basic reason that we are talking about implementation research. It's helping us understand this black box of how do we get from the what, that's the evidence-based interventions, to the health outcomes, such as satisfaction, function, and health status improvements that we in the healthcare field are focusing on. So behind this black box, Proctor and colleagues make a push for not just thinking about the evidence-based interventions, but also encourage thinking about the specific components that impact implementation outcomes in the third box from the left. So let's begin by focusing on first the what. In this case, these are commonly called as evidence-based interventions. When we say evidence-based interventions, we are referring to programs that have demonstrated impact in terms of changing health behaviors and our health outcomes. So as such, these interventions could include programs, practices, policies, and guidelines. And there are several interventions with an existing evidence base across the cancer control continuum. So within the framework of primary prevention, you can think of several diet and physical activity group interventions that have known to affect health outcomes, to cancer screening tests for secondary prevention. You could think about the practice of shared decision making for the diagnosis and treatment aspects. And then there's been a lot of research on survivorship care planning and palliative care interventions in this context as well. So then we come to the how. The model focuses on these how-to components of making changes and implementing these changes to achieve implementation outcomes. So thinking about implementation strategies a little bit further, these are defined broadly as methods or techniques used to enhance the adoption, implementation, and sustainability of an evidence-based program or a practice. It is important to note here that the implementation strategies focus on improving implementation outcomes, such as adoption, implementation, and sustainability, and others like uptake, cost, fidelity, and feasibility too. So then the question remains, where do you find these implementation strategies? And there are several resources available. There are guides and checklists that highlight implementation strategies, but may not call them necessarily as such. For example, the behavior change technique taxonomy put forth by Susan Michie and colleagues is a good compilation of implementation strategies that some of you may be familiar with. Another resource is the Cochrane's effective practice checklist that gathers in one place all of the evidence-based strategies that have been used in this context. And then there are other taxonomies like the guideline implementation taxonomy by Maza and colleagues. With all of these resources, Byron Powell at UNC and colleagues have been making efforts to compile this into a collection of implementation strategies. They first began by conducting a structured review published in 2012, but this review really highlighted the need for generating in a consensus on the various terms that were being used to name these strategies. Thus was born the ERIC study, or the Expert Recommendations for Implementation Change. And what this study did is that they gathered a panel of 71 experts in the implementation science and practice field, and conducted three rounds of Delphi process, which is a structured communication technique, in order to generate a refined list of 73 discrete strategies in their article published in 2015. And Byron actually suggests looking at the additional file 6 in their online article for the most comprehensive version of the compilation. As a part of the ERIC study, they also conducted a concept mapping exercise with 35 experts who sorted and rated each of the 73 discrete strategies to conceptually distinguish them. They identified at the end 9 distinct categories, which I've presented here just to give you a snapshot of what they are. And we'll dig into these a little bit in detail. I'm going to use the next few slides to give you more simplistic examples of particular strategies within each of these categories. So under the category of evaluation and iterative strategies, one might think about assessing readiness in the context of understanding whether an organization is ready to adopt a specific intervention, say, for example, a peer-based support group for cancer survivors. So our colleagues from Canada have published a couple of Cochrane reviews on audits and feedback that might be worth your time if you're thinking about using this strategy for your proposal. Moving on to the category of interactive assistance, you might think about facilitation in the context of uptake of specific care delivery models in different organizations. So a lot of this work has been done in the VA, which has suggested that providing external facilitation from implementation scientists has helped in the uptake of integrated care models in terms of behavioral health. To the third category of strategies, adaptation to context is another set of strategies that help with implementation in different organizational settings. For example, you could think of the need to promote adaptability for a diet and physical activity program if you were to implement it in a clinical setting and then take it to a community setting. So the next category of strategies that deals with training and educating stakeholders, let's consider developing educational materials. You can think of these in the context of promoting the uptake of cancer screening services. In terms of supporting clinicians, we have research studies that have studied the strategy of reminding clinicians through the use of EMRs, electronic medical records, in the context of improving uptake of HPV vaccinations for parents of young adolescents. For strategies that develop stakeholder relationships, there are several studies that have looked at informing local opinion leaders within an organization, such as a large health system, that can help influence the implementation of clinical practice guidelines. For the seventh category of strategies that are categorized under engaging consumers, we could talk about involving consumers and family members, which has been studied as a strategy to implement newer technology interventions for supporting care of cancer patients at home. Under the category of financial strategies that have been long studied in terms of regulating provider behavior, a good example in current research has been thinking about altering the incentive structures for providers that adopt the practice of shared decision-making when making screening and treatment decisions with patients. And thinking about the changing infrastructure, a good amount of research has been conducted on studying the mandating policy changes in the context of HPV vaccination, where a few states like DC and Virginia who have legislation requiring HPV vaccination at school entry. So let's take a minute here and think about why would we want to study implementation strategies. Studying these really helps identify and explicitly think through the implementation strategies and the building blocks of multi-level strategies for research that are often not understood, represented by the black box that I showed you a little bit earlier. Understanding implementation strategies may also help researchers get closer to specifying the active ingredients of what impacts implementation outcomes. So this is very important in the field of adaptation and fidelity to think about what are the core elements of an intervention. We can track the use of different strategies through the different phases of research too. A set of different strategies might be applicable in the preparation phase versus a different set of strategies might be applicable in the actual adaptation phase. And lastly, we can begin to highlight the under-researched strategies in particular research contexts. So you might think, how are implementation strategies often selected? And this is a slide that I've borrowed from Byron, who has borrowed from Justin. So, some of you might have seen this slide in other presentations, and as stated by Martin Eccles, a professor at Newcastle University, he says the most frequently used model is the Isla-Guyette. And you might ask me, what is Isla-Guyette? It seemed like a good idea at that time. So how, even though these have been selected that way, I want to encourage you to think about selecting these with certain ideas for your project. And so how should you select implementation strategies for your research proposal, keeping in mind the context, the research settings, and the particular outcomes that you're focusing on? Some things to consider would include the context of your research in terms of settings, the nature of your work. Think about how theoretical models, and 61 of these exist in a review from Tabak and colleagues. Think about how these models could help understand specific strategies to target at. Consider the participation of all stakeholders who would consume your research, and think about the research questions that you're trying to answer with their participation. And last but not the least, consider what practical and empirical evidence has to offer in this context. Some helpful resources for selecting strategies include the use of existing conceptual frameworks like the CIFR, or the Consolidated Framework for Implementation Research, which provides important constructs to think about, or one that helps you think about the various phases of implementation, like the exploration, preparation, implementation, and sustainment model. Consider the checklist of determinants that have been put forth by Plottorp and colleagues, and if either of these don't fit your particular research context, you could use literature reviews to understand what has been done about this before, or qualitative and quantitative methods to conduct studies that can help outline specific determinants. Some methods like the concept mapping and intervention mapping have also been described in this context by Byron Powell and colleagues recently in their article. A note of caution is to beware of the mismatch between the identified determinants and selected strategies. Since a review done by Bosch and colleagues did note that even though most studies identified barriers at the team and organizational level, they ended up selecting educational strategies to implement interventions in practice. So just to give you some examples of how you would map strategies to determinants, if you found that there was a lack of knowledge among the providers to improve the uptake of a practice, you could think about educational sessions to help with implementation of the practice. Similarly, if you found that there was a perception-reality mismatch, audit and feedback would be a good strategy to help implement interventions in that context. A lack of motivation would result in using incentives and sanctions for encouraging the practice. If there was lack of belief in attitudes, peer influence and opinion leaders might be good strategies to use. And if you noted that there were some problems with the system of care, process redesign would be another strategy to use in that context. In order to move forward with this line of research, Proctor and colleagues in their 2015 paper have called for the better specification of implementation strategies as they are used in research. Some of the recommendations involve naming your strategy and defining the strategy as it has been used in your particular research context, so that consumers of research can understand your particular use of implementation strategies. They also encourage researchers to specify the strategies used under 7 domains: the actor who enacts the strategy, the action by using words for specific actions like to engage or to assess or to develop, the action target, as in who the strategy would target, and identifying the units of analysis, temporality, when the strategy is being used, dosage, how frequently the strategy is being used, the implementation outcome being targeted, and to provide a justification for why the specific strategy or strategies were selected for this project. And much of this information is informed, comes from the context, theory, evidence, and stakeholder participation. Just to walk you through an example in the Proctor article that describes clinical supervision as an implementation strategy. Hopefully, this example gives you an idea of the granularity required in thinking through implementation strategies. So in this context, the actor is a clinician who is an expert in the clinical innovation and has been recommended by the treatment developer. This clinician provides clinical supervision by phone to answer questions, review cases of implementation, make suggestions, and provide encouragement. The target of this clinician is newly trained clinicians in this innovation, and changing their knowledge about the innovation, skills to use the innovation, optimism that the innovation will be effective, and improved ability to access details about how to use the innovation without prompts. How frequently the clinical supervision should begin within 1 week following the end of didactic training, and they specify the dose once per week, 15 minutes for 12 weeks, plus follow-up booster sessions at 20 to 36 weeks. The implementation outcomes would be the uptake of the innovation, penetration among eligible clients and patients, fidelity to the protocol of the clinical innovation. And the way they justify it is from previous research that suggests that post-training coaching is more important than the quality or type of training that was received. And then they have a reference for the research that supports that. Here's another example of research in cancer that has explicitly described the use of implementation strategies. This is an article by Karen Glanz and colleagues which presents an overview of the Pool Cool program, which is an evidence-based intervention to improve sun protection behaviors. And the program developers partnered with the Parks and Rec Department to implement this program with swimming pools and the personnel involved, using specific implementation strategies to increase the organizational adoption of the program. So they focused on skill training, they did modeling, reinforcement, and used persuasion. So having presented some easy to think of examples, let's think of an example that may not be as clearly defined. There have been long-term efforts in preventing colorectal cancer mortality through the use of colorectal cancer screening interventions. The United States Task Force has reviewed the evidence and has concluded several modalities, including colonoscopy and stool-based tests, to be effective in reducing colon cancer-related mortality. So these are the evidence-based interventions. And efforts to define and encourage the use of implementation strategies has been a relatively newer field of research, which is still evolving and hasn't thought through the nuances in terms of its applications in various research contexts. With this in mind, I wanted to introduce you, if you're not already familiar with, an excellent resource that houses evidence-based intervention programs categorized under specific cancer topics called the RTIPs, or the research-tested intervention programs. And so when you search for colorectal cancer screening within this database, specific programs that such as the automated telephone calls to improve completion of testing or the mailed brochures for appointment keeping for screening colonoscopy show up. And although these have been categorized as intervention programs, if you apply the definition of implementation strategies, it appears that the first program is targeting an implementation outcome of completion or, say, for example, uptake. The second program targets appointment keeping, which again is uptake. As such, you may notice the lines between what is considered an implementation strategy per the newer definitions and what are interventions per the accumulated literature on well-studied topics can be a bit blurry. Another reason why there may be lack of clarity surrounding strategies is because interventions often try to address individual level health outcomes. And when we consider implementing these interventions, we often think about impacting population level uptake. As the field is making progress in applying this concept in different research contexts, and indeed several of us here at NCI have been thinking about implementation strategies for some time now, it remains imperative that we all take efforts in specifying their use in each of our research contexts. I wanted to conclude by talking about some specific research questions you may be able to ask when incorporating implementation strategies into your research context. Think about, so we might be able to conduct some comparative effectiveness studies to test whether a set of strategies might achieve implementation outcomes versus another set of strategies. We may think about understanding mechanisms by which implementation strategies can impact implementation outcomes. We may also consider thinking about what implementation strategies work best for particular interventions and particular settings. So hopefully this has been helpful guidance to get you oriented to how we've been thinking about implementation strategies